Blog Talk Radio.
Hello and welcome to episode 164 of Songs of Selah here on 17 Numa Radio. Thank you for tuning in this evening. I'm your host, Scott Thomas Outler, and it is Monday, November the 15th, 2021. I hope everyone's new week is starting off on a high note as we hit the midpoint of the month. Coming up in the next segment, I'll be joined by tonight's guest, Elisabeth Horan. Elisabeth is a friend of the show and has been a guest on several past episodes through the years. She'll be returning tonight to talk about her latest collection of poetry, The Mask, which is available through The Broken Spine. The Mask is an ekphrastic book of poetry written in response to Frida Kahlo. I'm looking forward to finding out about the process of bringing this collection to life, as well as what else has been going on lately with Elisabeth at Animal Heart Press. So stay tuned for a conversation with and poems from Elisabeth Horan coming up in just a bit. And in the meantime, please be sure to subscribe to the channel while you're listening to the show. And if you're interested in checking out past episodes of Songs of Selah, they can all be found in the archive at 17numa.com. Drama. Feel the drama. Someone, somewhere, has something to sell ya. I bet my bottom horseshoe. And it's probably about 80% fear and the rest foolish behavior. But it could just be the next God-blessed masterpiece or some prophecy of apocalyptic romance. I confess my sins not to the crosses you bear, for I have a few of my own, along with a fire to contend with. Remember when Caligula anointed his horse as a senator of Rome? Ever hear the spin about how history repeats itself? Well, these modern creatures are of the same ilk. Stone cold, batshit, cray cray, caw, caw, Judas goats gnaw on the tin cans of their own spiritual destitution. That was Wares, followed by Cock-a-doodle-doo, a couple of my recent poems from the past 2 weeks at Dissident Voice. Thank you, as always, to Angie Tibbs for including my work at her site each Sunday. I don't know about you, but my plan for this holiday season of 2021 is to enjoy each moment to the best of my ability, to be thankful for good family and friends, to get my kicks during these final weeks of colored leaves before the wind sweeps their beauty off the trees and back to the soil, and to settle in for a happy Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year ahead. That's generally my plan on any given year, but the world has turned screwy and society has gone completely sideways at this point, so who the hell knows how many more opportunities for celebration, and peace for that matter, are going to be available moving forward into the future. So I'm soaking up each day for all it's worth, keeping my head on straight for whatever is heading our way down the pike. I'd like to thank Dustin Pickering, editor-in-chief at Transcendent Zero Press, for having me on his show Parrot Literary Corner recently. I had a good time speaking with him about poetry, politics, and the lunacy going on in the world at this time. The link to the show is up now in a new post at my website, 17numa.com. I'd also like to thank Bindya Vishavkarma for translating four of my poems into Hindi. Those pieces were published in the latest issue of Setu Mag, and Hindi is now the 13th language that selection of my poetry have been published in. I thought I'd read one of those poems tonight. It's an excerpt from one of my books released through Alien Buddha Press, abstract visions of light. This is here and now and after. Bury my bones beneath the dirt where trees once towered before civilization took hold. When the time comes, let my remains bathe naked in the soil. No casket, no box, no boundaries except the caress of earth itself. Dance and sing atop the plot where I'm laid to rest and make merry at a funeral filled with laughter. But until that fateful day arrives, let our eyes flow with tears of joy. Let our tongues tease out prayers of peace. Let our lips shout words of love. And let our lives be spent making the most of every moment with which we're blessed. All right, I think that'll just about wrap things up here at the top of the show. Wanted to close this segment out with a poem read by Mihaila Melnick. It's one of her pieces from our new collaborative book, Evermore. So let's check out An Apple Is Enough from Mickey before heading into a music break, and then we'll return on the other side with tonight's guest, Elisabeth Horan. Stay tuned.
An apple is enough. If you bite from the apple, you might find all pleasures of the flesh and the worm, resurrection of the senses, inner chaos, neurons split by testosterone, hematic confusion, guilt without guilt, stripped, just like the worm that digs the pulp with tenacity. Primo, do not fear. She doesn't want to deprive you of your reasoning. If anything, she'll help you see beyond the peel of the divine fruit. They said that Yahweh had a wife who sat right beside him. I don't care if it's true, but I like how it sounds.
Welcome back to Songs of Selah. If there's anyone interested in appearing as a guest on a future episode of the program, please feel free to get in contact with me via email at 17numa@gmail.com, and I'll be happy to set you up for a show here toward the end of the year. Tonight's guest, Elisabeth Horan, is an imperfect creature from Vermont advocating for animals, children, and those suffering alone and in pain, especially those ostracized by disability and mental illness. She is editor-in-chief at Animal Heart Press and co-editor at Ice Flow Press. Her newest collection, The Mask, releases in November of 2021 at Broken Spine Arts. Her poetry collections can be found at Fly on the Wall Press, Cephalo Press, Twist and Time Press, Moonchild Magazine, and Animal Heart Press. She is a poetry mentor to many up-and-coming brilliant poets and proud mama to Peter and Thomas. She has earned a master's in English and her MFA in poetry from Underwood University. She teaches English and writing at her local community college. Welcome back to the show, Ellie. How are you tonight?
Hi, Scott. I'm good. I'm really happy to hear your voice, be here.
How are things going with you lately there in Vermont?
Things are okay. I know I've come on the show before and just instantly started crying and been like, yeah, I'm having a hard time. I think I did that last time. So I was kind of determined not to do that this time. Although I will say that mental illness is a real fucker and it doesn't really leave me alone. So I'm fighting to be okay and keep moving and keep mothering my kids and keep working and keep in the poetry world, but sometimes it feels incredibly hard. So that's kind of where I'm at. And I'm really happy to be here in a place that I feel safe and loved and able to be myself without judgment. And so I thank you for that. And, you know, if I cry, it's going to be later. It's not going to be right now. Later on. But I'm thrilled to see you, and thank you for having me back and all the support you give me and Animal Heart and the whole literary community. I mean, you're just such a treasure and a gem, and we love you very much.
The love is reciprocal, and hopefully we'll maybe have some tears of joy by the end of the show as we delve.
That's what I'm hoping. Yeah, let's go for, like, those happy tears, those are the good ones. I'd be up for that.
I was going to say, I definitely appreciate your honesty and the troubles of the world, I think, weigh down upon everyone more heavily than ever. And so just sort of facing that head on and finding those spaces of comfort through your art and through family and through those experiences that are meaningful are the best defense that we have.
That really it, like, finding people to surround yourself with who understand what it's like to be in pain in your mind and with mental illness and who don't walk away. You know, I think people who sometimes I feel like I've lost a lot of loved ones because they don't always understand or they can't deal with the intensity of it. And then I lose them. And the people that I am trying to stay close to and trust are the ones who don't leave, don't walk away, stay by your side, even when things are really ugly. And then that's your family, that's your tribe. And then likewise, when they're down and out, you're right there. Just, even if it's just to say, like, I'm here, I have no idea what to do to help you, but I'm not leaving either. That can mean a lot, you know?
Yeah. Life can be a war zone, and having those people that will get down in the trenches, when things are raging, definitely so important to have.
Yeah.
And maybe that's a good place where we can start off the conversation here tonight, is talking about how poetry, writing, art can be used as a therapeutic tool, and how do you go about the process of taking the angst and anxiety and depression and those sorts of feelings of this world and transmutating them into something positive and a reflection of life that other people can relate to by pouring them into your heart?
Yeah, that's such a good question. I as I have grown and mutated and published as a poet, like I have, so has my opinions on it, you know, because there's this thing like, you know, writing through trauma, writing through your pain. Does it help? Does it help the poet feel better? I'm not sure it does, but I still think it's worthwhile. Because if you write a poem about, you know, losing a baby through miscarriage or inability to have babies, and a lot of my poems with Frida Kahlo deal with that, those issues. While it might not heal all of my pain that I had a miscarriage, you know, another woman might read it, or the husband of a woman or family member might read it and go, you know, well, that inspires me that she wrote really honestly about it, and that's exactly what we were going through, and we feel less alone. And I think that's really why I write the things I write. It's that simple, like, so other people will feel less alone. I think with mental illness and depression and trauma, we isolate. I know I do. It's the exact wrong instinct when you're feeling sad and alone and strange in your head to say, okay, I'm going to shut myself off from everybody who cares about me and hide in my bed with my cat. It's like the least healthy thing we can do, but it's a very like normal response to severe depression. So, you know, my hope is that like my poetry could, even if it reaches one other person who says like, okay, well, she wrote about it. I'm not that weird then, you know, I'm not the only person to feel like a failure. I'm not the only person to feel this depressed. And that in itself, that's like that one connection can save someone's life, literally from suicide or addiction or whatever. And I, you know, we kind of have this saying, animal heart, like poetry saves lives. And I really think it does. And it's our honesty and like the trust we have in our reader to share this shit that is so hard, knowing that the community will not ostracize us for sharing it, and that it might save a life. And I think that's why we do what we do. Because it isn't easy to write about trauma. It's not. It's really incredibly hard. But it's like, what else am I going to do with it? You know, hold it in and lay in my bed with my cat and isolate, or share it? And I never really knew how to share any of the trauma in my life until poetry. So at least now I have a voice and a way to speak about it that I never had before. And for the most part, in a place that feels safe. I mean, Twitter doesn't always feel safe, but again, the people you surround yourself with help a lot with that. So, yeah. Hopefully that answered your question.
Absolutely. Social media outlets can be a double-edged sword, but it's all about sphere and bubble we put ourselves within to get that positive reinforcement. But one of the tools of a writer or being in that place of discomfort when you do go into that space of isolation that you're talking about and sort of separating from the world, it is having that notebook in hand. It becomes almost a friend or an ally in the journey of trying to get those reflections out. So doing that is the first step. And then, as you said, getting that outlet of having an audience now that reads it and getting that feedback is so important too.
Yeah, right. It's, and it reminds you, you know, when people make comments, like if you publish a poem, I think one of the most amazing experiences I had at the very beginning, so this would be 6 years ago now when I published my first poem, and it was on the Feminist Wire, and it was It was like Stay Mommy and Wellbutrin in My Brain. It was about postpartum depression, you know, and someone took a minute to write a comment saying, like, this is exactly how I feel. And thank you so much for saying how you feel, you know, and so it clicked in me. It was like, this is worth doing. This is worth sharing. This is worth putting these things out there. Because clearly I touched somebody with those two poems that, you know, I never would have met her otherwise. And made me feel less alone, right? So, you know, it's like holding hands with your reader is a really beautiful concept to me, and one that I think about a lot. Like bringing your reader with you and holding their hand and getting through the poem together. I think about that as I write. I really do.
Going through that journey, and that sort of takes us to your new book. It's the second collection that you've written about Frida Kahlo. And talking about going on that journey with someone, I know that last time you talked about how you almost had a spiritual resonance and the synchronicities that lined up between the two of your lives.
Mm-hmm.
So it's someone passed on. Obviously, you're in that mental space of consciousness with another person. Can you talk a little bit about this latest collection, and what was it? What were the similarities to the first time, and what was it like getting back in communion with that spirit?
It's fascinating. Like I said, I like to be holding hands with my reader and trying to think about how they are going to receive the poem, how they're going to feel, what I can do to help them on the journey. But at the same time, I really like to write poems in the voice of my heroines. So this is my, you know, I have one that I did for Emily Dickinson. I have one I did for Plath. And now this is my second for Kahlo. And I really like the challenge of, you know, writing about somebody that I admire, that I feel a sisterhood with, a kinship with, who also suffered in ways that I have suffered in life and in trauma and in loss and in yearning, and, you know, study them, try to get into their minds, try to hold their hands, and trust that, like, they're bringing me into their world, and then I'm going to share stories from both of us. And I mean, it sounds kind of cheesy, but it's true. Like, I take it really seriously. And I find when I'm writing a poem in Frida's voice about one of her paintings, like, I think my writing is better because my standards are higher, because I want to please her. I want to honor her, respect her. It raises the stakes, you know, because I'm not just writing in my own voice about Ellie's dumb little life. Like, I'm writing about Frida Kahlo's life through my eyes and her eyes at the same time, and trying to bring the reader with both of us. So it's like a challenge that I love. And my first collection was Cephalo. It didn't get a lot of attention. It didn't get marketed very well. I felt really kind of let down, honestly, about the whole thing. And, you know, in my mind, it was like my masterpiece, the masterpiece that I had finally achieved. And I worked so hard on it. And it just didn't work out for many reasons. And I think that happens sometimes with books. The stars don't align for them for whatever reason. And I was bitter about it and frustrated. And I was like, you know what? Okay, I can't get that book back, but I can start over, because there are like endless Frida paintings, and writing about Frida paintings is easy for me. Like, it feels completely natural. I just sit down, I just pick one. I don't have to come up with an idea. I just pick one and sit with it. and then write the poem. And it's so fun. It's exciting. And it's like it's this sensual, intimate, religious, sisterly, feminist experience that, like, yay, right? I mean, what could be better? So I just feel like I could write poems for her all day. And so I did. So I just kind of started over, and I had been very, very determined to work with Broken Spine because I got it in my head that I wanted to work with them, and I kind of harassed them with emails for quite some time, being like, okay, I have this idea, I have this manuscript, I have this. And finally they're like, okay, well, if we're going to be interested in one, it would be a Frida. I'm like, okay. So I sat down and wrote a book for them, you know. It took me probably a year, and they agreed to it finally. So my determination paid off. Doesn't always pay off, but when it does, it's exciting. And they've been so wonderful to work with. And already, I mean, this book has had a lot of attention, a lot of positive feedback. And it's very different than the first. It's more of a chapbook. It's more focused on, like, kind of the end of her life and her bisexuality, her gender, her politics, her and Diego, and her love affairs. You know, it doesn't start at my first one started at her bus trolley accident when she was severely injured, disabled for the rest of her life, and goes through to her death. So it's like almost like a biography. This one is more kind of, I don't know, it's a little more quirky. It's a little softer. It's just focusing on things about her that really impress me and that I have in common with her. And I'm much more in this book than the first one. Like, I make appearances, even she says my name, like, Ellie, make a new stanza here. Like, she's talking to me. It's kind of interesting, like, you know, I'm writing it, but it's in Frida's voice, and then she addresses me. I think that's cool. So I really, like, let myself merge with her more visibly this time, which felt exciting. I felt like I had earned it after doing the first book. Like, I'm like, okay, I can take this to the next intimacy level with her. So,
yeah,
like, we're ready.
When life throws you those curveballs, which it inevitably does, especially in the indie publishing world.
Oh, my God, yes. Mm-hmm.
Kick around at the rocks and curse the sky, or you can get back on the horse like you did and just create a second.
Right. You can be like, I hate this, isn't fair. I hate this, you know. Or you can just try again. And that's what I did. So, and, you know, maybe someday my first one will get the attention it deserved. And writing this book will only help that endeavor to bring attention to it. So I'm hopeful, you know.
Exactly. You never know when a
I know it felt good to write it. And it helped me, like, let go of my anger and frustration about the first book. To just write something new, Ellie. Stop, like, rehashing what happened. and just move on. Write something else, you know? So
when you're getting in that spirit of responding to her paintings, that's obviously a certain headspace you're in. But then when the poems are done or you're away from the page, your voice is sort of still communing with you? Are you, like, feeling her energy in dreams or throughout the day? Or does it ever, I guess the point is, does it ever leave you, or is it, like, there throughout the whole process in some way?
I think at this point she's always there. I'm not sure I've ever dreamt about her, but I've dreamt about things that, like, would definitely mirror things in her life, but that are happening to me. You know, I've spent so much time studying her and studying her art and kind of conversing with her in my mind through these poems that, like, she feels like a sister, or a lover or a best friend. You know, she's, I feel incredibly close to her, and I feel like I understand what she went through and what she stood for and what made her happy and what made her incredibly angry. And we just have a lot of similarities. Like, you know, we're both kind of these stubborn, feisty, passionate sexual entities that are overflowing with art. And then there's kind of these male figures standing in our ways at certain places. And, you know, I don't know. It's really uncanny to me, like, how much I feel like I have in common with her, even though she was Mexican and, you know, lived in a different time period in a different country. Like, I just understand her. And I think she would like these poems. I really do. I think she would like them and say, like, hell yeah, sister, let's go have a shot of tequila. That thing, that badass poem. She wasn't afraid of her self-narrative. Like, she would paint things that could be very upsetting for society. And I'm not as brave as that. I don't feel as brave as her at all. I'm only trying to, like, keep up with her barely. With what she already produced. So her painting, my face coming out of my vagina, you know, I wrote a poem that, like, tried to keep up with her on that level, but that's not the same as writing a poem like that in 1930s Mexico. You see, like,
right.
She was the feminist pioneer who did what she said what she was going to say, regardless of consequence. And I fucking respect that. Like, that takes a lot of courage.
Absolutely. Yeah. Society is an absurd proposition at this point and has been throughout the ages. So anyone pressing those buttons and opening perception up to new pathways is doing a good service for us all.
It's so universal too, though. Like, so she was writing, she was painting pictures of her miscarriages and abortions. I'm now writing poems about miscarriages and abortions, but, like, it still needs to be talked about. It's still hurting so many women. Infertility hurts so many women and men and families, like. For the men that love the women who are struggling, like, we're all, I just think it's such a, like, hush hush thing. And I don't know why it has to be, but it is. And it's just like I have this book I've written about miscarriage, the miscarriage I endured in 2018. And I've had trouble finding a publisher for it. And I think it's because, you know, they're thinking, well, who's going to buy a book about a miscarriage, right? And they might be right. Like, that's depressing. But at the same time, I mean, why not? Why not write about that? She painted about it. Why can't I write about it and tell my story? It might make another woman out there who had a bunch of miscarriages and now infertile, realizing she can't have a baby, wouldn't that make her feel less alone? Again, back to that. So I think there's value in writing about severe trauma like that and loss. And Frida knew that too, somehow. She did. Like, she knew what she knew the impact, I think, and relished it probably. Because otherwise, how would you have the courage to do what she did?
Well, the fact is you have written about it, and you'll find the right publisher for it. And
Eventually I'll find the match that understands. And I do think you have to be really patient sometimes, because it is all about, like, who's the publisher who likes that voice, who can handle that. It's not going to be everybody.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like I said, I mean, it took me a year of badgering Broken Spine. And I finally got my way, so.
Keep banging on the doors.
You just tell them why you want to work with them, and then you don't back down. You just keep coming back. You know, say, okay, well, if what I brought before wasn't quite good enough, I'm going to go back and I'll come back when I have something better. That's what I kept doing, and it worked. Mm-hmm.
Well, you're obviously still riding the high energy of, you know, having this just come out into the world, this second venture into Frida's world.
Yeah.
Is there any plan now to go back and do a trilogy at some point? Do you think that energy is going to return?
I think I probably should. Yeah, it seems right at this point, doesn't it? If I've done two, to have a trilogy and sell them as a group. Broken Spine, if you're listening, I'd like to do that with you. Alan, wink, wink. Yeah, because there's so much more I could do. There's so many more paintings. I'd like to do one that is just focused on her and her animals. You know, she had all these animals. She had this incredible garden, but then, like, animals in it who were kind of her best friends and also her children, because she couldn't have children. So, you know, she had, like, a baby deer, and I have a poem about him. She called it El Granizo. It was her little deer, and she had monkeys, and she had little dogs, and she just doted on them, and they were her, kind of her everything. And I think you absolutely can be a mother to a little dog or a deer, or, I mean, I don't think you have to have a human baby to be a mother. You can mother anyone who needs a mother, is what I think, and that counts, and I wish I could tell her that. So I think I might like to write a book about that for her, to kind of give her solace in the fact that, like, she was a mother, even if it wasn't in a traditional way. Because I think if anything kind of hurt her in her life, if anything hurt her the most, it was that, of not being able to have a child. So that might be the third. And I'm glad you asked that, because now I have my plan. I need to take a note of this.
Yeah, that's a great theme
book.
You just
Frida about
her
animals. And she has so many self-portraits with her animals, you know. I'm literally typing this to myself in an email. Self-portrait with animals.
Right on. The Gaia nature itself. Not necessarily humanity.
Frida, third in the trilogy. There we go. All right, well, I have my new job.
Add it to your list. You're always hammering out so many books all the time.
Well, yeah, kind of. Kind of. I mean, I did hammer out so many. And actually, it's so interesting, Scott, because during COVID, I kept saying to people, I'm like, I'm not writing. I've lost my nerve. You know, I think I had told you that last time, you know, like, lost my self-confidence. And then come to find out, I wrote this book, and I wrote one that the working title right now is called Dumb Space or Blank Slate. And it's about me and my depression during COVID. And the idea of it was, like, how do you portray depression that is so bad that it's really hard to describe? Like, it kind of goes beyond, like, I don't feel so good. It's like, how do you share that kind of darkness and pain in a poem? How do you even get there? And so that's what I was trying to do, to see if I could get there. And I'm not sure I did or not, but I have it submitted to Sarasa's Poetry, and it looks promising. So, yeah, because you know what I mean? Like, there's poems like, I don't feel so good. And then there's poems like, my brain is bad, right? Like, I feel like there's a difference. I'm not even, it's hard to even explain to you what I'm trying to say. Like, it's just, there's this abyss that I'm trying to describe.
Yeah, I think that's what art is for, getting to those places that go past basic language, sort of digging into the roots of what it is to be conscious itself, the shadow aspects of where life even came from, what the hell are we doing here, what's our purpose, why is there pain and suffering, and how do I explain that without just pulling my blood and guts out upon the page?
Because, I mean, you know me, I've written a lot about mental illness. I mean, all my books are somewhat about mental illness, but this one, you know, came after being hospitalized in 2020. A lot of the poems started from that experience, which was like more traumatic than healing. And it just went downhill from there. And it's like, how do you tell somebody, how do you tell people what happened in your head and what any of that felt like? And that was a really big challenge in my mind to portray that, and to portray that for other people too, like anyone who's been inpatient in psych. How do you share what that's really like? Because it's rough.
I would think, especially
with
written word as well, because if you're a painter or a musician, you can kind of go into the abstract concepts of putting emotions onto the page or into the notes, but trying to explain those concepts without words, but having to use words because that's the only way.
You don't get to hide behind like. Yeah, there's nothing to hide behind. It's just, if you're going to really tell it, then, you know, buckle up, like, here we go. So I tried to, and I don't know, we'll see. We'll see what happens with it, if I succeed or not, I don't know.
I think it's also interesting how that sort of persistence of being a writer pays off when you least expect it. You know, you feel like you're in writer's block or things aren't necessarily flowing, and then all of a sudden you look around and say, well, wait a minute, there's a lot of stuff already here that sort of appeared out of nowhere when I wasn't even paying attention.
It is, and that's where this started, didn't it? Because I was like, I haven't written anything, I'm too depressed to write, and then I was like, I actually wrote 3 books, I think, and the third one is about Fiona Apple and poems that go with her songs. And I think it's good. And, I would love to find a publisher for that one too. So yeah, it's interesting. Obviously my brain was playing a lot of tricks on me, cause I thought I was completely paralyzed, but it was, you know, working with, Broken Spine, you know, there was a lot of this kind of like, I would write Alan and be like, I don't know if this book is good. I don't know what to do. I need to write more poems that are better. And he was so incredibly patient with me and would be like, Ellie, you know, I accepted your book. Like, I'm telling you it's good. You need to trust me. And I would just keep sending him more poems, like trying harder to please someone to make it perfect. And, you know, it took a lot out of me, and no one was asking me to do that. Like, I was just doing that to myself. And finally he wrote me, I sent him a poem, and he was like, Ellie, it's time to stop. Like, the manuscript's done. Like, we're not switching any poems out. Like, you can stop. But he did it in a really gentle way. And I had to let go that I was being super neurotic about trying to make it the perfect, the best thing it could be. And it just needed to be what it was. And I couldn't, like, I don't know what I was doing. I was obsessing over it big time. You know, Alan's been a great editor for this project because he's very calm and measured, and you know, he doesn't give a lot of extra words. He's just is who he is. And then there's me on the other, who's like total opposite, just verbose and wild and emotional. outbursts. And so we complimented each other beautifully.
Yeah, great to have that voice that finds the balance in between.
Yeah, he would just be like, Ellie, that's
not
that's
so far
done now. We're going to move on.
Seeking that.
But he never got annoyed. Perfect. Like, he never got frustrated or annoyed at me. He never, ever, like, made me feel bad or neurotic or anything. Like, he'd just be like, okay. It's so cute. It's very sweet, really, when you think about it, because he was taking care of me in a way.
Well, we're going to hear some poems from the new collection or anything else you want to read coming up here shortly, but I did want to bring in a friend to the show here.
Aww.
Co-editors there at Animal Heart Press.
Is this when we do the happy tears?
Hey.
Beth Gordon to the show.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for coming, sweetheart.
Of course. I've just been sitting here drinking my glass of wine and listening to y'all's conversation.
Oh,
so awesome.
Yeah.
What type of wine are you sipping on?
Oh, some red something or other.
Whatever does the trick.
Some red blend. Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Red blend. You know, when I was talking before about how you have to surround yourself with people who won't give up on you, Beth is very high on the list of that family for me.
Oh, sweetie. Same.
Yeah.
Same.
Yeah.
Well, what's going on there in Illinois? Is that where you're at, Beth?
No, that's where my cell phone was born, but no, I'm in Asheville, North Carolina these days.
That's right. We talked about that when you were on, having moved there.
Yeah, I've been
beautiful
here a couple
scenery
of years.
Of Asheville.
Oh, yeah, it's great. I'm loving it. Oh, it's good. I was listening, Ellie, when you were saying how during the pandemic you're like, oh, my God, I'm not writing. And then suddenly you're like, oh, wait, look at all these poems. I was the same way. I kept, like, every week when I get on, like, the Zoom call with JD, who's super prolific, but I'll, you know, I'm like, I have writer's block. And then a year later, I'm like, oh, look, I have two whole books. So I get what you're saying.
Yeah, it's like you don't realize you're even doing it because you just have this mindset that you're not creating.
Right.
And then you're like, well, I guess I was, even though it was incredibly brutal, I was.
Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting, huh?
And I think there's something to that that's not just naturally, oh, look how these poems magically arrive. There's a certain amount of discipline and persistence that comes in the years leading up to it where you get yourself into that routine of being a regular writer and putting in the work every day so that when those moments of not feeling at the best arrive, your sort of natural instincts have been overridden and put to a point where they just sort of carry you along because you put the work in to begin with. They balance you
and
back
I've just come to accept the last couple of years because I think, you know, there was a period of time where I was just in a writing frenzy almost and just writing multiple poems a week. And now I've come to accept that part of the writing process is the periods of times where I'm not writing, where I'm just living, you know, and then maybe I'll write something, but like it's okay. This whole idea that we have to produce, you know, in our society that puts so much emphasis on about our worth, on our ability to produce something, whether it's, you know, working in a factory or making money or whatever. and we apply that to our creativity, and I think that's harmful to apply it to our creativity, you know? It's like, just step back, and this is art. This isn't an assembly line. Okay, to not write every day. If you write every day, that's great too, but it's okay not to. It's okay to let yourself absorb things and live, and then, you know, come back to the art. So that's where my head's been this last year.
Well, I think that's an excellent point, because you get to the place where you're just trudging over the same ideas and reliving the same experiences without any
I think that's
material what, life actually lived.
I completely agree with what Beth was saying. Like, I mean, I went through an absolutely manic 2 years of writing, what, 6 books or something, you know? And those were like fun and exciting to write. And then you go into this period of like, I'm writing these poems and they don't feel very good. And I have no idea what their point is going to be, but they're coming out anyway. But it's like so murky. And it just sounds like we've had a similar experience with that, you know?
Yeah.
It like more like trudging along, just this trudge of like self-doubt and like, where is my voice going?
And also,
what am
just
I doing?
I think that, you know, social media, as long as we don't forget that it really is, that it's not real life, and that it is just a tool to use. I mean, it's a tool to connect, and it's a tool to share and even promote our work, but to not get pulled into that trap of having to constantly, you know, tweet and put stuff on Instagram and get that sort of instant, you know, endorphin kick from the feedback. It's like, that's a death trap. No, that's not real life.
It is.
It's not real life.
It's not real life, but so many people make it their life and live and die by it. You know, the Twitter sword.
Yeah.
Fall on the Twitter sword. Like, that's going to be my new saying for that. But it is. It's at some point you have to step back and go, I'm not going to survive any of this unless I get this shit into perspective.
Right.
And remember in my head that if I got canceled on Twitter tomorrow, would I be okay? Yeah, I would be.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like.
Right.
I wouldn't
die.
Well,
just to get back
to the
joy of creating. Just.
Yeah.
Without all the eyes on you, you know, just.
It's hard to have.
I feel like I became.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just became overly aware of all the eyes on my work and lost the joy. And so I've just tried to get back to that.
Well, and not even
the
eyes on your work, but the eyes on your responses, the eyes on how you handle, because when you're in a press and running a press, as we are, you know, the eyes are on everything else too, not just your own poems. And the stakes go up higher. So, and it's like, then having the press publishing start feeling stressful. And it's like, how do you get away from that and keep it in perspective while keeping your press from coming under attack? Right.
Right.
And I think that's something at Animal Heart that we've handled very calmly and strategically. Don't you think, Beth? I mean,
I think we do a good job of that. And I think that part of that is by being very author-centric
and not reactive,
and just being about our writers and showing them respect, whether it's somebody whose book we're publishing or somebody whose poem we're publishing in Farrell. We're very respectful of our writers.
Yeah.
Because without our writers, we wouldn't have anything to publish. That's the thing
right.
that baffles me about
right.
other publishers. Like, yeah. That's all. That's
yeah,
a whole another hour-long conversation. And
well, and that's been the mantra of Animal Heart from the very beginning, is that when an author sends you their work, they're trusting you. You know, they deserve your respect for that gift, which it is a gift, because you're not paying them necessarily. And whether you take it or not, to treat that person with respect and gratitude, you know?
Yeah.
And it should just be that simple. And that gets lost.
While y'all are talking about Animal Heart Press, I think we have another member of your team here on the line.
Hi.
Yeah.
There she is.
Thank you, sweetheart, for coming.
You're welcome. I'm so lucky.
Yeah.
How is everyone?
Amanda's getting her day going. We're good. I'm just glad to see you, sweetie. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm.
Good to be here
glad
to talk about
you
your amazing book. Now, you know how you were talking before about a third Frida book? I've had a brilliant idea. Let's talk after the meeting.
Oh, tell. You tell.
No, I'm not telling that. It's a secret.
Oh, it's a secret. You guys realize Amanda basically learned to speak Spanish by editing my first book for about 6 months. She went through that with me, right? And now she would like edit the Spanish because she could see the patterns. It was fascinating and brilliant. So she went on that long journey
and
with me.
I went off from there and I hopped on Duolingo and started learning some more. That's
Did
your
you?
Fault,
oh, good. Yep. All my fault. Pretty much everything.
You made me bilingual.
But no, she did. Yeah. No, you had a knack for it. Amanda's been on that Frida journey with me for some years now. Mm-hmm.
All those books are so good. I love Frida. She's just such a complex, interesting character. And there are so many layers, and I definitely see echoes of her in you and your artist.
Yeah.
And so it kind of makes sense. It feels like a natural fit for you to be writing about Frida.
Yeah, thank you, sweetie. Yeah, it kind of makes sense, right? Like, but it, you know, it's cool, too, that it's been, I started writing these in 2018. And it just keeps going deeper, you know, it just keeps getting like, it morphs each time with each poem and with each book, like we go to a new place. So I love that it's never stagnant. It's always fluid when I write for her.
Yeah. And it's just such beautiful poetry to read, especially for me, my favorites are some of the ones where you sort of, there's a blend of Spanish and English, now that I can speak enough Spanish to kind of follow it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It just becomes this whole other experience, which I just love.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's such a cool challenge. And like, people have asked me, like, do you think about where, you know, when you're going to put in some Spanish or... And I'm like, no, I really don't. It's totally by ear, you know, because I'll often rhyme the Spanish with the English. You know, so it's just melodic. It's just the musicality of it and the rhythm. It's not like, okay, this part better be in Spanish for emphasis. You know, it's not like that at all. It's just, my head just goes, okay, and then I just break into the Spanish and then I go back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It makes total sense.
But I've decided, I mean, the whole reason for me learning Spanish in my life, which I've spent, you know, 25 more and plus years doing, and was like determined to be fluent in was to do this, you know, because there's not really any other reason. I don't speak it in my life. I live in a very white area that speaks English. Like, I never was able to figure out a job with my Spanish, but it was to be able to write these poems in Spanish, Cazuda. And it was worth it. It was totally worth it.
Absolutely, it was.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, Amanda, what's going on there in Australia? And how are you, and what's going on with your work lately?
My summer seems to have disappeared, which is a little bit disconcerting. But I've just come back from a beautiful week of off-grid rest time because they finally let us out of lockdown. So the first thing we did was leg it the hell out of here. And it was just gorgeous. And I spent a lot of time in nature in some of the most remote parts of Australia. And it was lovely. And I'm currently working on developing a project that's a blend of creative nonfiction, personal essays and poetry around nature and connection and the current disconnect between generations around the planet and what we can do to come back together to build a better future. And so I've been doing a lot of reading around that lately and working at the moment on a personal essay that has become quite a long read, but hopefully Ellie's going to help me edit it down a little bit.
Yeah, so
that's kind of what I've been working on, and there's going to be some art and photography in that as well.
Very cool. Glad to hear that you're able to get back out into the world, experience the depths of nature again.
Yep.
My favorite thing is to be in the wild, and for 9 weeks, I think it was where I am, and I'm lucky because in some places it was 9 months. But for 9 weeks, we were locked in and we couldn't go anywhere. And it did a number on my mental health in a big way.
Yeah, I'm sure. My thoughts have been with everyone in Australia watching what's been happening there, other places in the world as well. But New Zealand and Australia seem to have had a little bit heavier of a hand.
Yes.
So thank God you're back out in the world.
We're out. We're out. Hello.
Let's go to the phones here. We've got another caller from a 618 line up there in Illinois. 618, are you there?
Hi, guys. It's Lisa.
Lisa.
Hey, Lisa.
Hi,
Lisa.
Hi, ladies. How are you all? It sounds like you guys are doing some good work.
Well,
we try. I mean, it'll turn in. I mean, I was just listening. I was off for a little bit and just got in when you guys were talking about that when you do stuff that it's not always perfection. That's not always what you want. You don't know why your voice is writing like that, but it will come to fruition at some point. And I think that's just part of being a writer, guys. I agree with you guys. And I always tell my students, you're allowed to write the worst stuff in the world. I think we have to give ourselves grace. But
that's
you are my mentors, so I'm listening very closely.
Well, Lisa, are my angel. Like, you're just, I don't know, you inspire me deeply, deeply. Having you at Animal Heart was a high point of a year, for sure.
Another thing that I wanted to mention when you guys were talking about how you guys are supportive of your authors, I've been doing a couple of book festivals and talking to other authors, and I've got to tell you, that was the one thing that I was so lucky to brag about. No one else could bring that to the table. No one. They were amazed So I got to say kudos to you, strong warrior women that help us and guide us. So thank you.
Sweetheart.
I have to tell my funny story now. Scott, when Lisa launched her book, we actually were in a position to do a live event for her. And Ellie and Beth met Lisa, and they had a live reading in a restaurant. And, of course, because I'm on the other side of the world, I couldn't attend. So after the reading, they video called me. I was on the side of a mountain in the middle of nowhere, hiking up this random goat track. And my phone starts ringing, and it's these three beautiful women on the other end having the time of their lives, and they were so excited. I was just freezing my backside off in the wind and cold. But I got to be there in spirit, but it was just so lovely to see. There was so much joy and so much life, and it was just beautiful.
Yeah, what a dichotomy.
Yeah, that was a beautiful weekend.
That
amazing
was.
That
your
phone got reception.
It's funny. I get reception in the strangest places, and I have no reception in places you would really think I should. Reception on the side of Mount Kosciuszko is frighteningly good, and that's Australia's highest mountain.
I thought, Amanda, you were going to tell the story about how I went outside the restaurant and called you, and I was like, Amanda, honey, I need to tell you something. And you go, I already know
I've seen
the credit card charges.
I was like, we need more wine.
Like, we need more appetizers and wine, you know, and oops. And she forgave me, so it was okay, but it was
you're
just
all right. I'll keep you
like,
around.
Oh, I already know what you've been up to. That's what happens when you give me a credit card and turn me loose on the town.
Behave yourself.
Yeah, probably Beth should keep the credit card when we're there. Oh my goodness. Yeah, we are going to AWP, aren't we?
We are indeed. Yeah, I'm going. I'll be there.
Lisa, I can't wait to see you, honey. Oh my God.
Yeah.
I have a plane ticket already. Like, I'm fully in.
I've got my hotel. I don't have my plane ticket, but I'll be there. I can't wait to see you guys.
I booked
the
booth at the conference. That was my job from the other side of the universe.
We have the booth.
Booked the booth. Yeah, that's taken care of. And the off-site reading, too.
Yep. Yeah, the off-site reading is going to be good. It's all going to be good. Whew. It's not that far away either. I mean, that's going to be here before we know it.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And JD's going to come, right? We're going to see JD. And
as far as I know.
JD will be there.
Yeah, we've got a few of our authors are coming along too. I don't know if I can name names yet for some of them, but we've got quite a nice list happening for our off-site readings. It's going to be amazing.
Oh, that's wonderful news.
Yeah, we'll have to try to do one other event, I think, that we should, you know, whether it's at a restaurant,
we can take that conversation offline, but yeah, I have some ideas.
Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
We can have a chat meeting.
All right, Scott, we'll just take over your radio show and have a press meeting.
I'm just
sitting in, seeing how the operation goes.
Well, we're actually very lucky with our operations. Generally, I have a mad idea and no one says no to me, and it's great.
Yeah. Not sure I've ever said no to you.
If y'all
only
like
when I told you to.
A little round robin poetry reading. Maybe here's
some
pieces from Ellie's new book to kick things off.
Sure.
And then also, if anyone else would like to call in and read some of their poems, they're more than welcome to do so. It's 646 668-8757. Call in. Join the fun. And
yeah.
Let us hear a few of your
poems. I think we have a few other people listening, like Kristen and Marcel. So don't be shy, ladies. Call in. I'd love to hear your voice. But no pressure, you know. All right, well, should I read a Frida, or what should I do?
Yeah, read a Frida.
Whatever you're feeling.
Yeah, all right. Okay, I'm going to read the first one of the book. It's called Para Dolores, and this is for her. She had a lover named, I think it was Rita de Dolores, who was like a Mexican movie star at the time. Okay. Para Dolores, no somos malas, amora. Touch me, lover. I long to feel your hand touching my neck. Drape my arm between your legs as if a last bastion for ease. I feel the arch of your lithe little foot, delicate as a root, securing itself to my knee. It will not be ripped away, will not succumb to the earth falling away into the mouths of men. They impose their vine of phallic truth, reaching for the sky, strangling the earth, touching nothing of consequence except for themselves. Flash of red, flash of evil, according to whom? God, the devil, men, los señores, well-educated terrorists who would rather let the world bleed from between our thighs rather than consider that I might prefer your touch, your kiss, our tongues, which perform the tango each time we enter the forest, each time we dance, intertwine chalice to chalice. Once touching, we are divine. The orgasms will be red. We own nothing, no sublimation.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Gets into the aspect that you were mentioning about this book. Deals a lot with sexuality and bodies.
Mm-hmm.
Find lips come up a lot throughout the poems.
Yeah. Yeah. And she was very openly bisexual, as am I, to an extent. You know, I write about it a lot, and something I'm proud of, and I don't need to be judged, you know? It's just, I love everyone, you know? I love women and men and everything in between. And if you have a connection with somebody, then, my God, enjoy it. All right, so this one's called The Mask, Volume 1. So this is, like, this was the title poem. And it starts with a quote, Si no te hubieras ido, sería tan feliz, which means, if you had never left, I would be so happy. That feeling when life is ending, when you know it's time to go, when your eyes have gone yellow, cut holes in the retinas and turn them to blue. Oh, that house. I've told Ellie to make a new stanza here to describe how I have died in that flowering house, the way in which women have flowered in that house. At 18, I was punctured in the way a sword enters the bull, and yet I did not die. Neither did I die when you fucked my sister, querido mío. See how I will never succumb to anything but my own body. I wear this because I feel ugly. I wear ribbons to cut the blood flow, to incite the beauty. My dog still loves me. The punctures remain. My monkey adores me, and I owe so much money. Make a new stanza here, please, Ellie. Make them into cold rooms. Lock the doors. Let's hide inside the liquor and pain. Hacemos algo. Amor a la mexicana. When Alejandro left you deformed, and now me too deformed. Diego, if you love me, come. Make love to me one more time in heaven. Por favor, come and fuck me in my mind.
I think
wow.
That piece might serve as the bridge point between the second and third collection. It wasn't the main theme of the poem,
there
you but
go.
You get into the animals a little bit there, kind of bridge that gap into the next
I
one.
I love
yeah,
that line.
Yeah,
I will
definitely.
Never... I will never succumb to anything but my own body.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so that
what
was a
line.
Beautiful line, Ellie. Golly. Wow. Wow.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Can I do, I'll do one more and then I'm done. This one
okay.
is for Leon Trotsky. This was her, so, you know, Leon Trotsky
hid him at her parents' house
for a time. She had an affair with him, kind of fell in love with him. He was much older than her. And it ended badly. She was jailed because she wouldn't tell them where he was. And he was eventually killed in Mexico. But this was her, this was a painting called Self-Portrait for Leon Trotsky. And I titled it Between the Curtains para Leon. It hurts me to write about how beautiful I was when you loved me. I am not that woman anymore. Standing there, softly radiating, any moment a bird could fly from my lips and land in your mouth. Oh, viejo, oh, mi amante, the idea of you so much better than the sex, not as good as I dreamt of. So I use our memory to invoke spite instead. Not for nothing, no, not for nothing, our lovemaking, the old hands, the withered flesh, so tantalizing, a tener un hombre como tú, at my heels, at my neck, to make someone so powerful succumb to my power, my allure, aye, the curve of my breast. I will later paint myself for you with pink nipples erect, a communist corset, a hammer and sickle just for you, painted tenderly over my ribs, my spine, my belly, my hips, for you to revere the idea that I wanted you as much as you wanted me. En realidad, era yo la cosa para ganar. Como que soy tan linda como la Virgen, imposible para sostener. I am the thing to covet. I am pura mujer.
There's so much music in your poetry, Ellie. There's so much. I love when you mix the English and the Spanish, and that was a beautiful example of it.
Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Thank you guys for listening. I love reading those, and I love practicing it. Because they take practice to get the Spanish in right, you know. you can stand. All right, that's enough of me.
Dancing upon the cadence of the syllables is such an important aspect of poetry reading.
Yeah.
Definitely do it well.
Yeah. Thank you, Scott.
Who's
it's so
up
fun
next?
To read to you guys. I know.
I can go.
Right.
All right. I've been doing, a lot of my writing happens when I'm in poetry workshops because I have a lot going on in other areas of my life, and doing a workshop allows me to safeguard that creative time, which sometimes is what I need to get going. But we had a poetry festival online here in Australia recently called Poetry on the Move. And one of the workshops I did in that amazing little festival was with a poet from Texas, I believe he's from, called James E. Cherry. And he ran a workshop on the poetry of history. And this is one of the poems that I wrote in that workshop. It's called Family History. One Christmas, we tried the European way, but in 40 degree heat, our air conditioners could not compete with turkey, crackling, every kind of roast vegetable and the thickness of plum pudding. We agreed that next year we'd sit on the back steps, young and old together, necking the sweat from cold beers and eating fat prawns caught that morning by my uncles and their sons, throwing the legs and heads in a bucket on the lawn, just like we always had. My grandmother was relieved to leave tradition behind in the country she hadn't called home for 50 years.
Wow. That might be my new favorite poem of yours.
Yeah. I have another one I can read you that I wrote in the same workshop that was very well received.
Do it.
It's a little bit longer. And this one comes with a trigger warning for traumatic death. So, and it's called Kuka. One cup of flour, 3/4 of brown sugar, 2 teaspoons each of cinnamon and mixed spice, 1 1/4 cups of water, 1/4 cup of milk, 1 pinch of salt, 4 big tablespoons of syrup. Let them overflow. This is the recipe that goes back all my days and my mother's and her mother's. Each afternoon at 3:30, thinly sliced with butter, served cold beside a steaming mug of sweet coffee, unheard of for a 6-year-old in Australia. My afternoons were spice-caked clockwork with my grandmother's lilting accent keeping the hours. She made kuka by eye, no recipe, no measuring tools, just years of muscle memory. If you asked her, she could never tell you how. She went by touch. When she drowned at 86, I believed all was lost, including that taste and smell that linked her to me in my distant past. When we cleared her old house, we found a piece of paper, which we thought might hold a key in a language none of us could read. But a travelling relative who spoke my grandmother's tongue unlocked the secret. Now I make that recipe for my children, submit it to the kindergarten cookbook, plaster it everywhere to make sure it stays found.
Awesome.
Oh, I got chills.
Great homage.
Thanks.
And as you were reading that, I was thinking of some of Lisa's poetry. Lisa, are you still on?
Yeah, I agree.
I've sat in Lisa's kitchen and watched the precision and care she takes in making a meal, and it's like watching poetry happen. And I was, when you were reading that, Amanda, I just imagined you sitting in Lisa's kitchen and
so cool.
You all cooking together. Wow.
Well, it's a very intimate thing for me. Cooking is very intimate. And what I really connected with in your poem is how you said there was no measurement. You know, it not only was there no measurement in the act of that, but her act of the love that she put in there. You know, it was just, yeah. So, yeah, what a beautiful, beautiful memory of your grandmother. Thanks for sharing that.
You're welcome. I share it far and wide, as I said, because for so long after she died, we thought that we would, like, none of us would ever be able to have that cooker again. And when we found the recipe and were able to get it translated, it was just a real moment, you know?
I think a lot of people can
Absolutely.
Relate to that sort of energy around this time of year with the holidays coming up, and sort of remember the meals that we had with family members. I can think of the cakes and divinity and fudge that my grandmother would always make. We were just talking about that with some family members a few days ago, so all those memories were surging through as you read that piece.
I think it's something a lot of people can connect to.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, thank you for sharing it, Amanda. And Beth, do you have anything you'd like to read tonight?
Yeah, I've got one. you know, Ellie, you were talking earlier about, like, just trying to think about, you know, what are you going to write next? Like, I've written this book and that book, and I've written on this subject and that subject, and what do you write about next? And I wrote this poem in April, the last time JG and I were in the cabin in Tennessee, and I keep coming back to it whenever I get asked to read a poem, and I think it's because it's sort of the door to what's next. And, you know, so all of my poetry has, you know, the themes of loss and grief, and that's always there. But I think with this, in some ways this poem is about my friendship with JD and that love, but it's also the idea of how do we, when we've lived with such unbelievable loss, and Lisa, I know you just had the anniversary of both your sister's and your mom's death, so I'm thinking of that with you. And my dad died a year ago, and of course, you know, Daisy's death. But how do we put our hearts back out there and allow ourselves to love the people we love, knowing that either, you know, either I'm going to die first or I'm going to lose them, you know, knowing that that loss is there in the future. And I don't mean obsessing about it or thinking about it every day, but knowing that, and yet we still put our hearts out there. Or we don't. Sometimes people can't. They can't put their hearts out there again after experiencing that kind of loss, and I don't judge people for that. I get why that would be. But so this poem is, it's about the secrets and language that friends have, but also about loving each other, knowing where it ends, right? It's called Full of Grace. You are the only other person who knows where we buried the moonshine. You know the names we gave to dogwood trees by the creek. Lost cause, foolish heart. Which roots hold Uncle Jim's secret cornbread recipe? Who else was there when the chickadee pair argued over twigs and dry moss? When we drank coffee that smelled like strawberries in a fire pit, when the geese across the valley traded hidden codes in their rhymes, a crate of martini glasses in the cobweb square beneath the stairs. Dig deep enough and you'll find the guard dog skeleton, and deeper still, an unnamed cousin who carried the bullet with him, his rib cage like a china cabinet. Another crate for champagne flutes and the deviled egg tray, painted with a bouquet of lilacs or hydrangea, we never could agree. We murdered the line of azaleas that failed to bloom for 3 cold springs. You know their final resting place and final song. I know where your mother's white dishes are hidden, the box labeled mouse traps and jelly jars, the key to your storage unit where her green stamp bureau resides. I know that your thyroid function is fine this week, but your hemoglobin levels are low. When the doctor calls, I won't ask which sin lit up your chart like a vine. When the doctor calls, I'll know. Black ice or arsenic, slick pine needles, the layer of pollen that turns your white car as golden as a calf, the log truck in your rearview mirror, smoking furnace, tangled electric lines, lead in the water, water in the basement, the last drop of whiskey, flat tire on a murky mountain road. I'm already ready for it. I'm wearing my funeral shoes. I'm already ready for it. Your heart in a puddle by the bed.
Wow.
So good.
Yeah.
So, you know, well, just one of my little lighthearted poems about all the ways
well,
my best friend might die.
But
I think
so
I've
powerful.
Heard that one in development some because lines were very familiar.
I think I've read it in June when at your poetry
okay.
reading.
Yeah. Yeah, very good. Love it. Love it. Recipes on roots. Love it.
Yeah.
Now you
read one, Lisa.
Capturing all those moments, those shared experiences, and I think that gets to the point, how do people open back up after a tragedy or loss? It's because of all those things you just mentioned and the connections that we share with people, and knowing how powerful
yeah.
those things are is what maybe opens people back up to being able to experience it again, those intimate connections.
Very true. Beth, I have nothing in front of me, sweetheart, but
okay.
for the offer.
Can someone just open up her book real quick and read one?
You guys.
Please.
Yes, I can, I think.
Amanda can. I know she can.
I think I can.
She's amazing like
green.
That. She's been called
yeah.
a wizard.
Oh, my goodness.
Right. Okay.
Bless you.
I'm going to read
Bless
the title
you.
Poem from Lisa's book, My Body Bonded with Superglue.
Oh, yeah.
I continued to move,
Beautiful.
Slowly surveying his body of land. A bird of prey has stolen my treasured chest. It forces me to reflect, survey the beauty of my upper torso. I make myself park on top. His temperature rapidly intensifies. He whispers, "You are complete." His hands are the puzzle pieces that fit into the space on my hard sternum. His empty hands continue to steer me on this fast current of winds. Our body's blood determines our arrival. We want to move as pebbles in the stream. We cannot slow. He is the only man I desire to ride with in my traumatic thunderstorm as it runs down my empty chest. He predicts I will be unstoppable because I steer directly into the winds. My body tenses until my involuntary release. She's good, isn't
wow,
she?
Wow, that was beautiful. Yeah, wow. Wow.
Yeah, Amanda read that. Amanda read the shit out of that. That's
yeah,
great.
Good. Thank you, Amanda. That was beautiful.
We should just, instead we should like take turns reading each other's. I think that would be an amazing show.
That would be fun. But
mm-hmm.
so you, when you read yours, Ellie, yours is so, it's seamless. It's almost
mm-hmm.
as if you are bilingual. Like, my mother's best friend is bilingual, and she speaks very good English, but all of a sudden,
mm-hmm.
she goes into the romance of her language, and
mm-hmm.
that, and we don't know what she's saying, but it's so beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and yours
sounds
is
beautiful.
Like that, the melody, like you said, the melodic. It's
mm-hmm.
yeah, you ladies are just awesome. I'm so glad I got to listen to mine on someone else's
mm-hmm.
tongue. That's just beautiful.
You're,
thank you, Amanda.
Yeah, that was beautiful. Mm-hmm.
Hopefully I didn't butcher it with my dodgy accent.
Oh,
no.
Not at all. Oh, no.
Dodgy?
Have I taught you another new Australian word?
No, we say dodgy, but I mean, I'm not sure if it means exactly the same thing.
Okay, maybe not.
And dodgy, like sketchy, like yeah, I don't know. Oh, funny, funny.
All right, well, things are spinning back to you, Ellie. Got a couple more you want to share?
Are
tonight?
They?
Okay. I do. I'm actually going to read one from that book I mentioned, Blank Space, for Noel. Yeah, it's got a bunch of working titles, but it's my, that, what we talked about, that very deep dive into the fucked up brain. Okay. It's called 20th Anniversary. I need a deep breath before it. Breathing. Space between I and you grows louder. My refrain of, are you okay? Your chorus rings, I'm fine. Yet nothing is fine. So messy like spilled Wesson. Cleaner clog. Dish bay of pig toys so filmed, so filthy. Gray water, gray clouds, gray hair coming round. Tell me when we could talk, when it would be best to bring up the idea of us playing house again. How it is you could leave for work and not bend me over and kiss me gallantly. Our baby dolls cry inside our house. They miss you and your funny smile so much. Our little raised home with its square cardboard sections, just baking soda boxes in reality. Beds like the sprung metal of mousetraps, toothpicks in a matchbox for the logs and the mantle, once the envy of the neighborhood. We were so grand in our flair for contemporary style, as young lions with our cubs, streaming kitchen gadgetry, past their ramshackle shoe boxes like there was no tomorrow. We were only salt shakers living in the suburbs at heart, couldn't keep up the tango, and our carpet of shag has suffered apart strand by strand. And the stairs, too, have come unglued, popsicle stick by popsicle stick. Wow.
Thank you for sharing. I think we're all just...
Thank you.
We're in the poetry mood, all just sort of deeply
yeah.
diving down
you
the energy.
No one has to say anything. Yeah, you don't have to say anything. No worries. Oh, can I do one more?
Yeah.
It's short. Okay, this is called Perfect Mother for Sylvia. I love you, Dad. Flower in your mouth. Button eyes, cotton head. I love you cut in half. It is a suit of fine ends. I see it on yours, mine. I wear the limp skin. Place benevolence. Perform your will. Execute debtors. Sing liturgical misery. I reap the widow cane. Sew mittens. Tame precepts. Slay kingdoms of having laid. I love you, dead. Rose mouth, blackened eyes, your grayish white head.
Sometimes when you read poems, it takes me like a minute or two just to catch up at the end because I just get so lost in what you're saying, and I just get tangled in the words and I have to sit with them for a minute.
Yeah. Yeah. You guys don't have to respond. No.
No, you put us into a trance with your poetry.
I think if you read a poem and people don't say anything, it's actually a compliment. Right? Like,
well, you leave people in profound thought, in very profound thought, because your words are just, I don't know, they just really evoke emotion and really tug at the reader to listen and to identify those words. Because, you know, each one is just, it's picked for a reason. So, yeah, I love it, Ellie.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, sweetie. I read that at a poetry workshop recently, and they were like, wow, you went from perfect mother to I love you, Dad. And that was bold. And I was like, well, it felt perfectly natural. Like, I didn't even think twice, you know, because that's what Sylvia would have done. That's how I saw it.
I mean, that poem was inspired by The Edge by Sylvia, you know, mm-hmm. Woman perfected, woman dead perfected. That. Anyway. All right.
I love your Sylvia poems.
Thank you, honey. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm proud of those.
You know how I love
those. I should do another
poems.
Sylvia book. Yeah, I know. I know you do. I think those are some of the best poems I've ever done.
I think so, personally.
Mm-hmm.
I'll read another
one. I think another
one.
Book of her. Oh, good. Can you read one from your first book with him? Like,
oh, I could. Yeah,
is that
I could
crazy?
Do that.
Well, you probably already have one in mind.
No, it's all right.
Like, I'm inventing a new language.
All right, before I read that, I'm going to read this because you put me in the mood to read a poem that has the word fuck in it, because where else could I do that? This is a poem. When you were talking about your who's going to publish your book about miscarriage, I'm like, who's going to publish my chapbook of 21 poems that are called Infant Obituary, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. It's scary to... publishers.
Yeah.
It is.
So
and I get that. Mhm.
This is one of those, and I wrote this earlier this year, and I was, you know, during the pandemic with every day, you know, all the loss and the and knowing all the loss that's happened and all the people that are now dealing with that loss. And anyway, this one's called Switchblade Hammer Template. Discuss the Cambrian explosion, new species arriving at reptilian speed. Shake sand off your feet for the journey ahead. Remember the way each grain will feel like a switchblade when you step into the machine. Fuck the machine. Fuck the machine. Do not ever say fuck. You will insult the wedding planner who lives next door. Share photographs with flower heads chopped off. Avoid comparisons to global plagues. Avoid comparisons to global plagues. Avoid comparisons to global plagues. 3 million dead are rushing to meet her. The machine spitting out their hammered souls.
Oh, my God, Beth.
Fuck the machine.
That's some epic, 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 Jesus.
You will offend the wedding planner next door.
That's a new plane. Beth, what have you been up to? Oh, my God. Always
I wrote, Amanda was there while I was doing it, where I wrote, like, 20 sonnets in, like, 3 weeks. And they're all actually
sonnets. I appreciated the swearing in it. I liked that. I thought
appreciate
that sounded
sharing that
perfect.
Piece, Beth.
You're welcome.
Beth, you read that so powerfully too.
Definitely a different style or a different voice coming from you.
Yeah, it was
awesome.
Mm-hmm.
But still,
all right. And for you, Ellie, I'll read. I'm inventing a new language.
Thank you.
This is the first poem in the first book I published that Ellie and Amanda published.
This was the poem that introduced me to Beth, basically. Mm-hmm.
I'm inventing a new language. I've been counting sparrow feathers for 1,800 days, and I'm as close to zero as I was the day I started. Splicing consonants from vampire, nouns from asphyxiation, learning to navigate better thick pronunciations of hurricane fables, jellyfish stew, hush puppies, and mermaid bones. I'm telling you, I have no oxygen, no saliva, no palate, no tongue, no divine precognition to form the future syllables, gnashing of teeth, tiny slivers of glass beneath my fingernails, robotic harmonies, air bubbles screaming like hunted rabbits inside copper pipes. I'm finding abandoned spoons in black Nebraska dirt, dormant tulip bulbs, the talking rag doll my father gave me on my third birthday when he emerged from the missile silo to help me blow out candles, the lilac dust in the back corner of my grandmother's lingerie drawer. I'm using a 3D printer to build a labyrinth from nursery rhymes and the lingering thunder of Emily Dickinson's burial gown, reimagined fortresses of quartz of bloom, reading the instructions to redesign my DNA, the source of my malfunction in mitochondrial couplets. Like the astronaut who returned to Earth only to discover that he was no longer his twin's perfect genetic double.
Thank you, Beth.
You're welcome, sweetie. Thank you for publishing that.
I love that one. I just do. It's so you to me, and this represents so much that we've shared and you've been through, and I just thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I was going to go to Amanda to see if she had one more she wanted to share tonight, but it looks like her call just dropped off.
Yeah, she said she just dropped off. Yeah.
She
said her call just dropped.
Okay, well, thanks for calling in tonight, Amanda, and talking with you, and glad things are better there in Australia for the moment, and hope it stays that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess maybe we'll go back to Ellie here, let you read one more if you'd like to close things out here tonight.
Sure. Can do that. Well, I'm going to just read the one that it's on and not overthink it. That's a fault I have, that overthinking, and then you can't make a decision and you're like, I don't know what to read. All right. So this is called Piochitas, and that means sideburns. And again, this is one that she wrote for, that I wrote for Leon Trotsky about a painting of hers for Leon. Piochitas. She called him like old man Piochitas, like with his gray sideburns. You stayed in my home. You stayed with me. I love the idea of you, fearless antithesis. I shut you out. You are not Diego. You are not 27. I am not a thing to fuck without consequence. In prison, I debated if the orgasm was worth the supposition of crime. I let you into my dress, under the ruffles. I love the power you carry, and now you are dead. I tell them nothing, not even what your lips felt like. Opening me, falling for me, the way yours were pushing against mine. Thank you, guys.
Absolutely absorbed back into it again. Well, a lot of powerful poems tonight, Ellie. New book, I read it earlier today. Congratulations.
Good.
Excellent.
Thank you, Scott.
And
thank you so much for hosting us.
Absolutely.
For always supporting
this has been
us.
Lovely.
Great.
Mm-hmm. Beth and Lisa, thank you so much for calling in and sharing your thoughts with us tonight. And once again, Amanda, thank you as well. And I guess we'll have another Animal Heart Press author on the show next Monday at 6 p.m. So
we will. Mm-hmm.
Do it all over again.
Have more fun. On Monday, yep.
Oh, it's that amazing. Next Monday? Okay.
Yeah, it's Monday, honey. I know. We did back-to-back. And, you know, his is just this massive book, this massive achievement. I don't even know how to talk about it, really. Like, it's just it's been such a journey for our press and for him and everything, and I hope people will tune in. He's a really beautiful human being, and his poems are out of this world, so... Right.
Very cool. Look forward to speaking with him and y'all next week, and we'll dive deep into that.
Yep. We'll see you then.
have another good time. So thank you, ladies.
Thank you, Scott.
Thanks, Scott.
Guys, have a good night.
Great week ahead.
Thanks,
y'all take
Lisa.
Care.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye, Lisa. Bye, Allie. Bye, Scott.
Bye, honey.
Bye.